Hallelujah. It's a $50 fine for phones. It's a $50 donation for phones. The only phone you need is 1-800-G-O-D.
Amen.
Praise be to God. Welcome to Friday Night Live. Oh,
Amen.
Tuesday Night Live. Hey, every day's the same. It's Tuesday Night Live. Praise God. All things are happening. Are you ready for revelation? Impartation? How about visitation? Oh, yes. God is preparing us for visitations. In the book of Genesis, in chapter 2. Let the anointing teach us tonight, my Lord. We did not come here to hear a man. We came to hear your spirit. In Genesis chapter 2 and verse 15. Glory. Is everybody there? Let's speak it together. Then the Lord God took the man and put him in the garden of Eden to tend it and to keep it. And the Lord God commanded the man, saying, "Of every tree of the garden you may freely eat, but of the tree of the knowledge of good and evil you shall not eat, for in the day that you eat of it you shall what? You shall surely die." Food for thought. Everyone say food for thought.
Food for thought.
That's the name of tonight's teaching. Food for thought. Adam and Eve were warned about spiritual eating. Why? To maintain connection with God. The reason why God put Adam and Eve in the garden with them is so that he could secure their identity. Remember, they were brand new. They were babes. Does everybody get it? God put them in the garden to train them so that they could secure their identity. But unfortunately, the enemy was in the garden. And the Lord warned them, if you maintain eating what I tell you to eat, you will maintain connection. But if you refuse to eat what I tell you to eat, you will be disconnected from me. You will lose your identity. Again, there was training in the garden. It was to secure their identity because they were babes. They were new creations in an eternal order and another form. In Genesis 3. So they had glorified bodies, didn't they? They didn't have blood. The life of the body was in the spirit. In Genesis chapter 3 and verse 1, now the serpent was more cunning than any beast of the field which the Lord God had made. I want you to know that God calls fallen angels beasts. And he said to the woman, "As God indeed said, you shall not eat of every tree of the garden." He was challenging her. Why? Because she was a babe. And a woman said to the serpent, "We may eat of the fruit of the trees of the garden, but of the fruit of the tree which is in the midst of the garden, God has said, you shall not eat it, nor shall you what? Touch it or agree with it, lest you what? Die." Then the serpent said to the woman, "You will not surely die, for God knows in the day you eat of it, your eyes will be open and you'll be like what? God." They already were. But they did not, their identity was not secured. Knowing good and evil. So the serpent knew. What was he trying to do? Prevent them from getting their identity secured. He knew that if he could disconnect them from the Lord, their identity would take a longer time to be secured. The identity of Adam and Eve was not yet secured. And again, they were to be like God, weren't they? They already were. So they partook of what the serpent enticed them to do. In other words, they disobeyed God, didn't they? Amen. They became rebellious. Rebellious sin is called, and sin, all sin is called deceptive food. Why? Because they partook of deceptive food. They partook of the tree of the knowledge of good and evil, which they were told not to partake of. It was deceptive food. That food killed the likeness of the character of God. And the character of evil now stepped into the body, causing a separation and disconnect from God Almighty. Psalm 51. Food for thought. Psalm 51. Starting at verse 1. I believe there will be a tremendous impartation, so make sure you might not get it all, but you'll get plenty of it. And reality will come. In Psalm 51, verse 1, let's speak it. Because what you speak is what you eat, and what you eat is what you become. Because this word is life. It is food for me and you. Reading it is not eating it. Speaking it is eating it. In verse 1, have mercy upon me, O God, according to your loving kindness, according to the multitude of your tender mercies. Blot out my transgressions. Wash me thoroughly from my iniquities and cleanse me from my sin. Now, I got to explain to you something. There's three areas. He said, cleanse me from my sin. The word sin means presence of evil. So when the presence of evil comes to entice you, when you participate, when you agree with the presence of evil, that act is called a transgression. When you do the transgression in that act, it brings a curse on you and your family line, which is called an iniquity. So now, until it's broken, not only do you get it, but it goes down to your children. That's why when you have sex out of marriage, you receive all the curses from that person you just had sex with. All of them come to you and into your children until it's broke. The Lord says that every third to fourth generation, it cycles inherited curses until somebody breaks them. Is everybody okay? Amen. So there's sin, which is the presence of evil. Transgression is the act because of the presence of evil influencing you. And when you do the act, you bring a iniquity or a curse on yourself and your children and your family line. Well, he knew this, didn't he? That's why he was saying, wash me thoroughly from my iniquity and cleanse me from my sin. Blot out my transgression. What was he trying to do? Get reconnected to God. What is he saying? Verse 3. For I acknowledge my transgressions, and my sin is always before me. Against you and you only have I sinned and done this evil in your sight, that you may be found just when you speak and blameless when you judge. Behold, I was brought forth in iniquity, and in sin my mother, what? Conceived me. So I want you to grab hold of something, that you and I were born in darkness. We were born in sin. We were born in iniquity. The only image or likeness that we had of God was we had a free will. And we are a triune being of a spirit, soul, and body. Other than that, we are known as children of wrath and a fallen nature. We are known as little devils. You little devil. Does everybody grab hold of this? That's why he said, sin is always before me. He was talking about him, self, the offspring of darkness. Behold, I was brought forth in iniquity, and in sin my mother conceived me. Behold, you desire what? Truth in the inward parts, and in the hidden part you will make me to know wisdom. Purge me with hyssops, and I shall be clean. Wash me, and I shall be whiter than snow. Make me hear joy and gladness, that the bones you have broken may rejoice. Hide your face from my sins and blot out all of my iniquities. Now, are you look at this. What does he say? Creating me a what? Clean heart, O God, and renew a steadfast spirit within me. What was he asking for? A new man. Give me a new spirit. Give me a new heart. Because myself is nasty. Do not cast me away from what? Your presence. And do not take your what? Holy Spirit from me. This is so powerful. He's saying, look it, I see that I am a man of sin. My hands are filthy. My heart is wretched. Please cleanse me. Give me a new spirit. Give me a new heart. And give me a Holy Spirit. Because I can't do it without the character of the Holy Spirit, who is the character of Christ, the eternal presence, power, and truth of God Almighty Christ, called the anointing. Does everybody understand that? Oh, verse 12, he says, restore to me the joy of your salvation and uphold me by your generous spirit. Then I will what? Teach transgressors your ways, and sinners shall be converted to you. Why? Because the anointing protects the new man and is used for service. I'll go a little bit deeper. You and I were conceived in sin. We were of the presence of evil, born separated and disconnected from God. This man knew repentance. He knew the only way, the first way to disconnect himself from himself and be connected to the Lord was through the blood of Christ. Why? Through repentance, it activates the blood. Remember when Adam and Eve fell, the first thing the Lord did when he removed them from the garden is he sacrificed an animal, blood. Why? Because the life of the body was no longer in the spirit. It became divided because a different spirit entered them, a fallen nature spirit. The new man was killed. That character was destroyed because of sin. But there was another spirit that came, the spirit of self, full of pride, lustful, an offspring of darkness. And the Lord said, the only way that you and I are going to reconnect is I got to reconnect you through blood. Because now the life of the flesh was in the blood. No longer was the life of the body in the spirit, because the body had become divided. Now it had a spirit, soul, and body. At one time it was united. Is everybody with me? Because Adam and Eve were eternal beings. If they fell and cut themselves, they'd bleed to death, right? Well, that wasn't what was going to happen. They were eternal beings. They spoke to God face to face. Adam named the animals. He saw the angels. Lucifer was a servant of Adam. And so were the fallen angels. They were in the garden serving Adam. Adam was now the ruler of the earth until Lucifer deceived him and caused him to partake. But he went through the weaker vessel, Eve, to get to Adam. Is everybody okay? What was he saying? Listen, restore me. Give me something new. I want new. I know my old man is not good. It's called self. Is everybody okay? Ezekiel 36. Ezekiel 36, 25. And we'll start at 24. Let's speak it together. And I will take you from among the nations, and I'll gather you out of all countries and bring you into your own land. And then I will sprinkle you with clean water, and you shall be clean. And I will cleanse you from all your filthiness and from all of your idols. And I will give you a what? A new heart and a what? A new spirit within you. And I'll take the heart of stone out of your flesh and give you a heart of flesh. And I will put what? My spirit within you and cause you to walk in my statutes, and you will keep my judgments and what? Do them. He says, I'm going to give you a new heart. There'll be a day when I give you a new heart. I'm going to give you a new spirit. And then I'm going to give you my spirit, my character, my anointing, the Christ. Again, the Christ is a representation of the anointing. He was the anointed one. The anointing is the eternal presence, power, and truth of God Almighty, which is the character of Christ, to be restored, to have a secured identity of who you are in Christ. Is everybody okay? The new heart, new spirit, the Holy Spirit. Why? Let me share this with you. It's very important. When you are born again, that's why there's two baptisms. The baptism of repentance is not, the water baptism is symbolic, but there's a baptism of repentance that when you repent of your sins, you are baptized, you are submerged, you are washed by the blood of Christ. You get a new spirit. Has everybody got it? Then there's another baptism. It's called the baptism of the Holy Spirit, which so many people lack. Because when the baptism of the Holy Spirit comes, that now, that presence, that anointing comes on you and covers your new man. That covers your new man. And now you are now anointed from high. You are now like Christ. Your new man is now an image and likeness of Jesus the Christ, the anointed one, an original state of being secured in its identity. Has everybody got this? Now it's used for service. Oh, hallelujah. So it's important that we understand something now. The anointing is the eternal presence, power, and truth of God Almighty. It surrounds the new spirit man, and it must be fueled to maintain protection and connection with God Almighty. It must be fueled. The anointing must be fueled, and your spirit must be fed with faith food. Food from God. Amen. What did the Lord say? Man cannot live by bread alone, but every word that proceeds by him out of the mouth of God. That means what he spoke, you got to eat. Is everybody okay? Proverbs 23. You have an invisible enemy. You have more than one, I'm going to tell you. But the most powerful invisible enemy you have is yourself. You live with it. You sleep with it. It does not leave you until you depart from here. But it's protected by the anointing. Has everybody got it? Ooh. Proverbs 23. Is everybody there? Good. We'll start at verse 1. Is everybody okay? Proverbs 23, verse 1, let's speak it together. When you sit down to eat with a ruler, consider carefully what is before you. Hello. And put a knife to your throat if you are a man given to appetite. In other words, you accept anything anyone says. Do not desire his delicacy, for they are what? Deceptive food. Deceptive food is sin. Do not overwork to be rich because of your own understanding. Cease. Will you set your eyes on that which is not? For riches certainly make themselves wings. They fly away like an eagle toward heaven. Do not eat the bread of a miser. Compromiser. Nor desire his delicacies. For as he thinks in his heart, so he is. So as a man thinks, he is, isn't he? It's called food for thought. Eat and drink, he says you, but his heart is not with you. The morsel you have eaten, you will vomit up and waste your pleasant words. Words. So what's he talking about? Eating words. Does everybody get this? Do not speak in the hearing of a fool, for he'll despise the wisdom of your words. Do not remove the ancient landmark, nor enter the fields of the fatherless. For their Redeemer is mighty. He will plead their cause against you. Again, as a man thinks, so he is. Food that feeds the new man is called faith food. Foods that feeds the old man is called deceptive food. Grab hold of this for a second. If you and I were born in sin, that's why we must be born again. So the old man was born in darkness. He was born in the presence of evil. He was birthed from the presence of evil. So what feeds the old man? Sin. The presence of evil feeds the old man. And what feeds the new man is every word that proceeds out of the mouth of God. So the word feeds the new man. But the oil fuels the anointing. Because the anointing is associated with fire. Has everybody got it? See, there's a hell fire, but there's a fire where hell can't touch. Hallelujah. Amen. Psalm 37. That's why the Lord commanded. He commanded all. When Jesus was here in Acts chapter 1, you read it. He commanded them not to depart from Jerusalem. They were all baptized in the Holy Spirit. He told 500 of them. 120 listened. The rest booked. They started denominations. They got religious. That's why they can only preach the baptism of repentance. They don't preach the baptism of the Holy Spirit because you can't give what you don't have. And then they deny it. And the Lord said, I command you to be baptized and filled with the Holy Spirit. Why? Because that's his character. That's the eternal presence, power, and truth of God Almighty. He said, this will protect the new man. You'll be covered. What does it say? That we are supposed to be ministers of what? Flames of what? Fire. The only way that you're a minister of flame of fire is if you are fueling the anointing. Glory. I love this. Okay, Psalm 37. Verse 1. Let's speak it. Do not fret because of evildoers, nor be envious of the workers of iniquity, for they shall soon be cut down like the grass and wither as a green herb. Trust in the Lord and do good. Dwell in the land and what? Feed on his faithfulness. Delight yourself also in the Lord, and he shall give you the desires of your heart. Commit your way to the Lord. Trust also in him, and he shall bring it to pass. He shall bring forth your righteousness as the light and your justice as the noonday. Rest in the Lord and wait patiently for him. Do not fret because of him who prospers in his way, because of the man who brings wicked schemes to pass. Cease from anger, forsake wrath, and do not fret. It only causes harm. We are to feed on his faithfulness, feed on his promises. Matthew 25. Woo-hoo. You'll never be the same. Who's your worst enemy? Self. Matthew 25 and verse 1. People really do not have the revelation of the importance of the baptism of the Holy Spirit and maintaining that anointing. One of the things the enemy tries to do is break down your anointing. If he can break it down, he can cause your new man to sin. Everybody got it? When the new man sins, it feeds the old man. Hear this. When your new man sins, it feeds the old man and breaks down the anointing. And then when the demon, now listen, then the old man gets stronger and begins to overtake the new man. And the demons that influence the sin, the presence of evil, get fed because they get fed by emotion. And if you'll notice, all sin is associated with emotion. So it's a multiple arena. Demons come up. They try to snare you. They shoot darts at you to do everything they can to shoot you. Why? They try to break down the anointing that's in you. They try to do all kinds of stuff to prevent you from worshiping God. Remember, reading your word just strengthens your spirit, man. Strengthens knowledge. But it's the anointing that protects the new man. And when you speak the word is what you get fed with. That's how you feed the new man. So when you read the new man, you're just getting knowledge. Does everybody get it? When you read the word, you're getting knowledge to the new man. But when you speak it, you're strengthening the new man. And then as you worship, you're fueling the anointing. As you fuel the anointing, a flame of fire is around you. The powers of darkness can't touch you. But they'll throw every kind of word and everything they can to get your attention so they can start to break down the anointing. As they begin to break down the anointing, they entice you to say something, do something that opens the door to sin, feeds the old man, and the old man begins to influence the new man. Because the old man is nothing but lust of the eye, lust of the flesh, and pride of life. And so when people fall by pride, it's because the anointing has been broken down. The new man has become weak. And now the influence of the old man is constant. That's why people don't lift their hands to worship, because full of pride. Oh, you can have all the knowledge you want. Listen, knowledge will do nothing but puff up pride. Hello? Oh, I know it all. I don't need to do this stuff. You flesh creature. No fire at all. Nothing but a wet noodle. You may be strong in the flesh, but you're stinking weak in the spirit. Verse 1, Matthew 25. Let's go. Then the kingdom of heaven shall be likened 10 virgins. A virgin is someone that's been washed by the blood of Christ. Amen? Who took their lamps and went out to meet the bridegroom. Now 5 of them were wise and 5 were stupid or foolish. Those who were foolish took their lamps and took what? No oil. Oh, man. Oh, they had the word. They spoke the word, strengthened the new man, but the anointing was not there. There was no fire. They were religious. They took no oil with them because they were lacking in worship. But the wise took oil in their vessels with their lamps, the wise. But while the bridegroom was delayed, they all slumbered and slept. And at midnight, a cry was heard. Behold, the bridegroom's coming. Go out to meet him. Then all those virgins arose and they trimmed their lamps so that the light could shine brighter. The problem was there were those who had oil and those who didn't. And the foolish said to the wise, did you notice? See, the foolish always go to men, not to God. And the foolish said to the wise, give us some of your oil, for our lamps are going out. Right. But the wise answered and said, nope. Why? Because you cannot buy somebody's oil. You must purchase your own oil by praise and worship. That's how you purchase your oil. It's called the sacrifice of praise. That's how you purchase. That's why the word says lifting your holy hands in the sanctuary. Why? You are worshiping the Lord. The greatest way to get filled and to fuel that anointing is corporate worship. That's why the word says forsake not to assemble. You can't do it on your own. No one can. But the wise answered, say, no, lest there should not be enough for us and you, but go rather to those who sell and buy your own oil yourself. And while they went to go buy, the bridegroom came. And those who were ready, everyone say ready, ready, went in with him to the wedding and the door was shut. Why were they ready? Ready, because they were cleansed. They had overcome sin. There was no sin. They were washed by the blood, filled with the Spirit. They had fueled the anointing, the fire. They were a flame of fire. Let me tell you, fire loves fire. And the fire of the King of Glory came, and the fire became fire. And the door was shut. Why? Because they were ready, and the other ones were left behind. Because they were still associated with sin. And afterward, the other virgins came also saying, Lord, Lord, open the door to us. Well, they knew the word. But they were sin. And the answer said, surely I say to you, I do not know you. Let me tell you, there's going to be many who this is going to happen to. Many. He said, watch therefore, for you know neither the day nor the hour in which the Son of Man is what? Is coming. Are you wise or foolish? You know, the enemy influences and distracts. He'll do everything he can to prevent you. He wants to disconnect you. He wants to break down the anointing. And if you've never been baptized in the Holy Spirit, speaking in tongues, and let me tell you something, that is not salvation, that's power. That's protection and service. That's something that you should desire. If you don't have it, you better go after it. And you go after it until you get it because it's a promise from God Almighty. But he ain't going to give you something you don't seek. He's not going to give you something you don't go after. In fact, he knows that there's so many idols in someone's life that he's waiting for that person to move them all out of the way and come after him with all their heart. And who's the greatest idol? Yourself. John 21. It's all about me. No, it's all about him. The trinity of the old man is me, myself, and I. Remember, Jesus said, I am. The serpent said, I'll be like that. I will. Wrong. I'll be like the Most High God. No, no, you won't, little varmint. John 21 and verse 15. Is everybody there? So when they had eaten breakfast, Jesus said to Simon Peter, Simon, son of Jonah, do you love me more than these? And he said to him, yes, Lord, you know that I love you. He said to them, do what? Feed my lambs. And he said to them again, a second time, Simon, son of Jonah, do you love me? And he said to him, yes, Lord, you know that I love you. And he said to him, tend my sheep. And he said to him a third time, Simon, son of Jonah, do you love me? Peter was grieved because he had to say to him the third time, do you love me? And he said to him, Lord, you know all things. You know that I love you. And Jesus said to him, what? Feed my sheep. What was he going to feed his sheep with? His words and his spirit. Does everybody get this? Feed my sheep. He knew that without being fed, why? Food for thought. As a man thinks, so he what? Is. All the influence of your old man is constant. It's full of pride, lust. His desire is only for himself. It's always about me. John 6. John 6:53. Speak it, please. Then Jesus said to them, "Most assuredly I say to you, unless you eat the flesh of the Son of Man and drink his blood, you have no life. You have no life in you." Isn't that powerful? You don't have no life in you. Unless you what? Eat my flesh. Unless you speak my word, because it is a ministry of the Spirit, which means breath. Unless you speak my word, which you will eat. Unless you worship me and sing my words. So many people just, yes. Quit doing all of this other foolishness. When the words are up there, you're to be singing those words. Why? So you can eat them. Those words are to feed and fuel your anointing and hope that you'll get to a place where you are baptized with the Holy Spirit to fuel your anointing. Why? That is fire. Has everybody got it? Whoever eats my flesh and drinks my blood has eternal life, and I'll raise him up at the last day. My flesh is what? Come on, 55. What does it say? My flesh is what? Food indeed, and my blood is what? Drink. He who eats my flesh and drinks my blood does what? Abides in me and I in him. Do you get it? Oh, snap. Why? Because the anointing, the blood, drinking the blood, fuels the anointing. Protects the new man and is used for service. Isaiah 10. There's a place when you are worshiping, you don't have to say thank you, God, anymore. You just need to sing the words. Amen? Amen? Thank you ain't going to do nothing. That's not God's words. Does everybody understand it? His words, what he spoke. There's a time when you say thank you and praise, and then there's a time of worship where you speak his words. So many people start praying during worship. It's too late. You don't need to pray during worship. You're to go after him. You're to get fueled. Amen? You should have prayed before you came. Isaiah 10. Hallelujah. Verse 27. Come on, you want the truth, right? It's reality time. This is real. Too many people don't get this. That's why they falter all the time, easily swayed. The old man is always impressing them. No, they're speaking pride on them all the time. Isaiah 10, verse 27, let's speak it. It shall come to pass in that day that his burden will be taken away from your shoulder and his yoke from your neck, and the yoke will be destroyed because of the what? Anointing oil. Let me tell you, your old man has been yoked to you. It must be broke constantly. What breaks it? The anointing. You're constantly always trying to break the old man. The more you are filled with the Spirit, the more you're fueled, the distance you are from the old man. So everybody got it. We are constantly to break off. Every morning you need to get up and break off the old man. Disconnect yourself from the old man because you sleep with that dude. He's there all the time, man. No matter where you go, you look in the mirror, there he is. Oh, gosh. You know, no, it doesn't matter. So you got to get him behind you. That's why the psalmist said, I always see sin before me. Why? Because he sees the old man. The old man gets fed on sin. Does everybody get it? Hallelujah. 1 John chapter 2. First John chapter 2. Food for thought. Who would have thought? Verse 12. Is everybody there? Let's speak it, please. 1 John chapter 2 and verse 12. What does it say? I write to you, little children, because your sins are forgiven you for his name's sake. I write to you, fathers, because you have known him who is from the beginning. I write to you, young men, because you have overcome the wicked one. I write to you, little children, because you know the Father. I've written to you, fathers, because you have known him who is from the beginning. I've written to you, young men, because you are strong, and the word of God abides in you, and you have overcome the wicked one. Do not love the world or the things in the world. If anyone loves the world, the love of the Father is not in him. Why? Because the old man is of the world, and he loves the world. And if the old man is ruling this temple, the love of the Father has been pushed out. For all that is in the world, the what? Lust of the flesh, the lust of the eyes, and the pride of life is not of the Father, but is of the world. And the world is passing away in the lust of it. But he who does the will of God abides forever. So he who does the will of God abides. So the old man ain't going to do the will of God. And he's going to try to prevent the new man from doing the will of God. Why? So he can hold the new man from going home. Little children, it is the last hour, and as you have heard that the Antichrist is coming, even now many Antichrists have come, by which we know that it is the last hour. They went out from us, but they were not of us. For they had been of us, they would have continued with us, but they went out that they might be made manifest that none of them were of us. But you have a what? You have an anointing from the Holy One, and you know all things. Why? Because the character of Christ through the anointing, the eternal presence, power of truth of God Almighty, knows all things. And that anointing that surrounds you, that flame of fire that surrounds you, is the same flame of fire that Moses saw. It's the same flame of fire that was over the tabernacle. So everybody get this. Now that flame of fire is over this temple. The anointing in Christ is the anointing, the eternal presence, power, and truth that surrounds a new man, protects a new man, and empowers a new man, and uses him for service. He breaks the yoke of bondage to the old man. People have no they don't have the understanding of the importance of the anointing of God. Religion just wants you to know letter. God wants you to know him. God is the anointing. Does everybody get it? God is the flame of fire. It says he's a consuming fire. God is presence. He is the anointing. And your identity is secured in the anointing, which is the presence of God. That's where the Lord was trying to train up. See, but when people come to Christ, they're babes. But I'll tell you, they grow very quickly when they get baptized in the Holy Spirit. Because they're taught by the anointing that's within them, as long as they keep fueling it. Oh. Look, after my visitation from the Lord, I didn't know the Bible. In fact, I didn't want to read the Bible. Because I saw too many hypocrites. I never read the Bible. I didn't know nothing about the Bible. But I knew my dad's voice, and I knew it pleased him. I kept telling him, why do I need to read the Bible? Just tell me what to do. And he kept telling me, I want you to read the Bible. I said, no, I don't want to read the Bible. And every time in prayer, the Bible would get closer and closer, and I'd be pushing it away. I didn't want to be a hypocrite. And I didn't want to fall in love with with written words. I wanted to stay in love with his presence. Oh, hallelujah. Because my identity was in his presence. So everybody got it? Oh, yes. Let's go a little further. Colossians 3. So is the enemy going to try to disconnect you? Is he going to try to prevent you from getting in God's presence? Is he going to try to prevent you from fueling the anointing? Yeah. Is he going to try and prevent you from speaking the word? Yeah. And then people wonder why they can't progress, get free, get healed, overcome evil, going back and forth, up and down in an emotional life, calling themselves Christians. To be a Christian is to carry the anointing. That's why it's called Christ-like. Has everybody got it? Colossians 3, we're going to start at verse 1. Would you speak it with me? Hallelujah. If then you were raised with Christ, seek those things which are above, where Christ is sitting at the right hand of God. Set your minds on the things above, not on the things of the earth. See, your mind, God is always first. None thing in the world, no money, no job, no family, no nothing. When the anointing has come and that anointing is fueled, nothing is first but Him. Every decision, every day of your life, all your thoughts always focused on Him. Why? Because in the anointing, He's in front of you all the time. All the time. You're not thinking about you, you're thinking about Him. Even when you're at work, you do what you got to do, but He's always there. Hi. And then you work. Then you invite Him to, what do you think about this? How do you want to do this? You know what? I'm stuck. What do we do? See, because we're partners now. I say, where do you want to go? What can I do to please you today? Hold on everything. I know you got to tell me something. Because this don't make sense. But what don't make sense usually makes faith. Amen. Glory. Is everybody okay? Set your mind on the things above, not on the things of the earth. Verse 3. For you died. Oh, yes. For you died, and your life is hidden with Christ in God. Now, wait a minute. You're a new man. See, what he's saying is you died to the old dude. Get away. Like a dog. One of those chihuahuas always trying to grab your ankle. Oh, it's always got a big mouth, but a little thing. Does everybody understand? You've been around many kind of dogs. It's just, but anyways. And so he's saying, you've died to the voice. You've died to that voice of the old man. You no longer listen to it. Amen? And your new life, the new man, is hidden in the anointing. It's called hidden in Christ. It's hidden where? In the anointing. Oh, glory. Verse 4. When Christ, who is our life, appears, then you will also appear with Him in where? Glory. Because when He goes, you go. Because you're in Him, in the anointing. Therefore, put to death your members which are on the earth, fornication, uncleanness, passion, evil desire, and covetousness, which is idolatry. Because of these things, the wrath of God is coming upon the what? Sons of disobedience, in which you yourselves once walked when you lived in them. But now you yourselves have put off all these anger, wrath, malice, blasphemy, filthy language out of your mouth. Do not lie to one another, since you have put off the old man, that little devil, with his deeds, and have put on the what? The new man, who is renewed in the knowledge according to the image of Him who created him, where there is neither Greek nor Jew, circumcised nor uncircumcised, barbarian, Scythian, slave nor free, but Christ is in all and in all. Your new man is hidden in the anointing. That's why the word says, he who is in Christ is a new creation. Ah. Oh. He who is in Christ is a new creation. He who is in the anointing is a new creation. Why? Because the anointing is influencing the new man to be like Christ. Old things have passed away. In other words, you ain't, no, I ain't doing that no more. There's no consideration of those things no more. Psalm 64. Food for thought. Psalm 64. Verse 1. First four verses, please. Maybe we better go a little further. Okay, let's speak it. Hear my voice, O God, in my meditation. Preserve my life from what? Fear of the enemy. How many of you know fear is a stumbling block? That begins, fear breaks down the anointing. Do you fear? How am I going to pay my bills? Do you fear? It'll begin to break down the anointing. Fear breaks down the anointing. Doubt breaks down the anointing. Unbelief ain't no anointing. Hallelujah. Hear my voice, O God, in my meditation. Preserve my life from fear of the enemy. Hide me from the secret plots of the wicked, from the rebellion of the workers of iniquity, who sharpen their tongue like a sword, and they bend their bows to shoot their arrows, bitter words. So what's he saying? Words are what are going to attack you. Every voice shoots a word, doesn't it? Amen? That they may shoot in what? Secret at the what? Blameless. Suddenly they shoot at him and do not what? Fear. Come on. They encourage themselves in an evil matter. They talk of laying snares secretly. They say, who will see them? They devise iniquities. We have perfected a shrewd scheme. Both the inward thought and the heart of a man are deep, but God shall shoot at them with an arrow. Suddenly they shall be wounded. So he will make them stumble over their own tongue. All who see them shall flee away. All men shall fear, and all shall declare the work of God, for they shall wisely consider his doing. The righteous shall be glad in the Lord and trust in him, and all the upright in heart shall glory. So listen, the enemy is secretly shooting at you. Look at every thought has a voice, every voice has a presence. I'm going to say it again. Every thought has a voice, every voice has a presence. It's either good or evil. Amen? Your purpose is to discern. You won't discern if you're not strong. That's where the word says, be strong in the Lord and the power of his might. Why? Because you're in Christ. Your spirit man is strong. You're protected by the anointing. You're being ministered by the anointing because you're a flame of fire. You're fueling that anointing. You're staying strong. You're separating yourself from the old man and anything that will fuel the old man. You stay away from it. You don't touch it. And you discern the voice of the stranger. God says, my sheep know my voice. My sheep know my voice. Amen? Amen? Remember, I want to share this again. What happens is the enemy tries to shoot with his voice, with the words, to cause the new man to open a door to sin, which is the presence of evil. When that happens, it feeds the what? Old man. Feeds the old man, breaks down the anointing, and feeds the demons with emotion. Ephesians 5. Who's your worst enemy? Yourself. Quit blaming the devil. The devil made you do it. No, you let him. Hallelujah. But you don't know what he said about me. Who cares? Hallelujah. Take dominion. Offense. Oh, man. Offense. You need to be defense. The anointing. People easily offended because they get rejected. God never rejects you. Who cares if man does? That means you're focused on the earth and your mind is not set on him. Does everybody get it? Ephesians 5, verse 6. Let's speak it. Let no one deceive you with what? Empty words. Hello. For because of these things, the wrath of God comes upon the what? Sons of disobedience. Therefore, do not be what? Partakers with them. For you were once darkness, but now you are light in the Lord. Walk as children of light. For the fruit of the Spirit is in all goodness and righteousness and truth, finding out what is acceptable to the Lord. And have no what? Fellowship with the unfruitful works of darkness, but what? Expose them. Expose them. Why? Because if you don't expose them, they're going to break down the anointing. They're going to cause you to agree with them. Sin will enter and strengthen your old man and feed a demon, and it will weaken your new man. For it is shameful even to speak of those things which are done by them in secret. But all things that are exposed are made manifest by the light, for whatever makes manifest is light. Therefore, he says, awake you asleep and arise from the dead, and Christ will give you light. That way you don't agree with things that are ungodly. You don't approve of things that are ungodly. You don't approve of abortion. You don't approve of same-sex marriage. You don't approve of everybody sharing the same bathroom. I mean, that's just nuts. Hello? These are things that are perverse. So you don't approve of things that are perverse. You don't approve of fornication. You don't approve of lying. You don't approve of any of those things. Look at whatever God disapproves of, you should. We hate evil. You should hate evil. And the works of the flesh, the Bible says the flesh profits nothing. Ephesians 2. Ephesians chapter 2. In verse 1, would you read it with me? And you he what? He made alive who were dead in trespasses and what? Sins. This is the old dude. In which you once walked according to the course of this world, according to the prince of power of the air, the spirit who now works in the sons of disobedience, among whom also we all once conducted ourselves in the lusts of the flesh, fulfilling the desires of the flesh and of the mind, and were children of wrath, just as the others. That's who we were. That's the old man. Amen? That's the old man. Lust of the flesh, lust of the eye. That's why Jesus said something very powerful. Deny yourself. He gave us a formula. Deny yourself. Why? Deny that dude. Deny that influence. Deny it. Deny yourself. Pick up the sword. Pick up the cross. Fight. And then you'll be able to follow. Because you will not follow unless you deny yourself. You can try all kinds of things, but you must walk away from him. Hello? Matthew 23. Matthew 23. In verse 23:25. Woe to you what? Scribes and Pharisees, hypocrites. These were the Sanhedrin. These were all the priests and so forth at that time. For you cleanse the outside of the cup and dish, but inside they are full of extortion and what? Self-indulgence. In other words, they're constantly feeding them the old man. Self-indulgence. Romans chapter 2. In verse 5, But in accordance with your hardness and your impenitent heart, you are treasuring up for yourself wrath in the day of wrath and revelation of the righteous judgment of God. Why? Because let me share this with you. When you reject God's counsel, you reject his word, your heart gets hardened. Every time you reject anything of him, your heart gets hardened. And it begins to build a wall that gets harder and harder. Verse 6, who will render to each one according to his deeds, eternal life to those who by patient continue in doing good, seek for glory, honor, and immortality. But those who are what? Those who are what? Self-seeking, promoting the old man. And do not obey the truth, but obey unrighteousness, indignation, and wrath, tribulation and anguish on every soul who does evil, of the Jew first and also of the Greek. But glory, honor, and peace to everyone who works what is good, to the Jew first and also to the Greek. For there is no partiality with God. 1 Corinthians 3, self-seeking. First Corinthians chapter 3. Glory. Is everybody there? Start at verse 1. And I, brethren, could not speak to you as to spiritual people, but as to carnal, as to babes in Christ. I fed you with milk and not with solid food, for until now you are not able to receive it. And even now you are still not able, for you are still carnal. For there, where there are envy, strife, division among you, are you not carnal and behaving like what? Like men, like the old man. Why? Because the new man had not been strong enough to overcome the old man. Even though the person has been born again in the spirit, he got a new spirit, but it's not strong enough. Why? Because he ain't been baptized in the Holy Spirit either. See, when a person comes to Christ and they're baptized in the Holy Spirit, that anointing comes. It brings more strength. They don't want milk, they want meat. So what happens is the new man is not strong enough to overcome the old man. And the influence of the old man is pride. Pride. Proverbs 16. Pride. Lust of the eye, lust of the flesh, pride of life. Pride. And the Lord says something very powerful. He says, if you're ashamed of me, I'll be ashamed of you. In verse 16, 17, let's speak it. The highway of the upright is to what? Depart from evil. The highway of the upright is to what? Depart from evil. He who keeps his way preserves his soul. Pride goes before destruction, and a haughty spirit before a fall. Better to be of a humble spirit with the lowly than to divide the spoil with the what? With the proud. So when people fall, backslide, it's because the new man is not strengthened. The anointing has been broken down. If they've been baptized in the Holy Spirit, they're not feeding their spirit man, the new man, by speaking the word. He's becoming weak. They're allowing sin to enter in. They're feeding the old man. The old man's getting stronger and stronger. And while they're feeding the old man with sin, the demons are getting fed by emotion. And pride leads them to destruction. 1 Corinthians 6. Hallelujah. Verse 7. Now, therefore, it is an utter failure for you to go to law against one another. Why do you not rather accept wrong? Why do you not rather let yourselves be cheated? No, you yourselves do wrong and cheat, and you do these things to your brethren. Do you not know that unrighteousness will not inherit the kingdom of God? Do not be deceived. Neither fornicators, idolaters, adulterers, homosexuals, or sodomites, nor thieves, nor covetous, nor drunkards, nor revelers, nor extortioners will inherit the kingdom of God. Why? Because that is the old man. And such were some of you, but you were washed, but you were sanctified, but you were justified in the name of the Lord Jesus by the Spirit of our God. All things are lawful for me, but all things are not helpful. All things are lawful for me, but I will not be put under the power of any. Look at this. Foods for the stomach, and the stomach for foods. But God will destroy both it and them. Now the body is not for sexual immorality, but for the Lord, and the Lord for the body. And God both raised up the Lord and will also raise us up by his power. Is everybody okay? Isaiah 58. Isaiah 58. Hallelujah. One of the things we need to do is fast the old man. Fast from that dude, man. Get him behind you, not in front of you. In verse 6, he says, is this not the fast that I have chosen? To what? Loose the bonds of wickedness. To undo the heavy burdens. To let the oppressed go free. And that you break every yoke. It is not share your bread with the hungry, and that you bring to your house the poor who are cast out. When you see the naked, that you cover him, and do not hide yourselves from your own flesh. Then your light shall break forth like the morning, your healing shall spring forth speedily, and your righteousness shall be before you. The glory of the Lord shall be your rear guard. Then you shall call, and the Lord will answer. You shall cry, and he will say, here I am. Why? When you fast and stop feeding the old man and start feeding the new man. 1 John chapter 5. One of the things the enemy does is try to get you to protect the old man. Pride protects self. Fear protects pride. Anger protects fear. Lying protects anger. And so forth. And every time you agree with one of those, you feed the old man, you break down the anointing, and you feed a demon or multiple demons. 1 John 5:18. Start at 17, I'm sorry. Would you read it with me? All unrighteousness is sin, and there is sin not leading to death. We know that whoever is born of God does not what? Sin. So when you are in a state of born-again state of being, sin does not have dominion on you. It cannot overcome you. Why? Because the new man is strengthened, and in the anointing, he's in Christ. He surrounded him as a flame of fire. We know that whoever born of God does not sin, but he who has been born of God keeps himself. Does what? Keeps himself. Keeps the new man from being what? Contaminated. And the wicked one does what? Does not touch him. We know that we are of God, and the whole world lies under the sway of the wicked one. And we know that the Son of God has come and given us an understanding that we may know him who is true. And we are in him who is true, in his Son, Jesus Christ. This is the true God and eternal life. Little children, keep yourselves from idols. And I'm going to close at Galatians 5. The Holy Spirit has given us a full course meal tonight. The anointing loves to teach. He loves to feed us. Galatians 5:22. It says, but the fruit of the Spirit is love. This is the fruit of the anointing, is love. Joy, peace, long-suffering, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness. Now hold on. Self-control means control over self. Against such there is what? No law of sin and death. And those who are Christ have what? Crucified the flesh with its passions and its what? Those who are in Christ, those who are in the anointing, have crucified the old man. If we live in the Spirit, let us also walk in the Spirit, and let us not become conceited, provoking one another, envying one another. Why? Because that will break down the anointing. Does everybody get this? He who is in Christ is a new creation. Old things pass away, all things become new. What you're eating is what you become. When you keep feeding the new man, he gets stronger. You feed him by eating the word and drinking, you're fueling the anointing. If you're not doing those things and you're rejecting them, you're feeding the old man. And the old man is creeping, getting more and more stronger and speaking to you. Pride, arrogance, fear, anxiety, stress, lust, desire, lovers of the world, no longer lovers of God, men pleasers instead of God pleasers. Listen, it's your time to arise. It's your time to kill the past and cut loose of the old. God is getting ready to do something mighty. 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 We must be in the Spirit for what's getting ready to happen. Amen? Praise God. Father, we thank you for your word. We are honored and blessed. I apply the blood of Jesus on every seed that's been imparted in each and every one of us that it will grow and bear fruit for your glory. I pray, Father, for each and every one here tonight that you'll bring revelation and impartation, that the word that was spoken will bring counsel, correction, direction, and conviction, that there'll be a thirst and hunger for more of you to come out of self, to enter into the anointing, the realm of the anointing, that pride would be destroyed, the old man would be separated, and a new creation would have fellowship with the King of Glory and be connected all the days of their life in Jesus' name. And everybody said amen. Amen. Be blessed and stay dressed with the glory of God.